All right, that's the finance minister in conversation with journalists after not being able to reach a consensus as far as the GST dual control is concerned, and the deadlock just about continues. But we're joined by a very power-packed panel here. Rajeev Dimri, V.S. Krishnan, Bhavna Doshi and Anita Rastogi all join us right here on ET Now, and Sachin Menon continues to be with us. Thanks each one of you for being with us. Mr. Rajeev Dimri, the finance minister did lay out the fact that the bone of contention seems to be dual control. There are many suggestions on the table, whether it should be horizontally or vertically divided, but the story of the day is that the deadlock on dual control just about continues. How big a blow do you believe this is to the entire GST process?
Well, I won't call it a blow. I think this is a very, very important issue for the states, of course, but equally for the taxpayers. I, as a taxpayer, and each taxpayer in this country would like to know which is the authority that's going to administer him, which is the authority that's going to assess him, because a lot of this dispute arises out of who the authority is. And the worst for a taxpayer would be that there are two competing authorities, two different authorities, one by the center and one by the state. So it's an extremely important issue for the industry, for the taxpayer. So just the fact that they have not been able to reach a conclusion today, I don't think that's a blow to GST, but it needs to be resolved. I think, on behalf of the industry is not fussed as to whether it's the center or the state. All they're saying is, give me one authority, because you can't have multiple authorities reaching multiple views on a single transaction. So the industry is saying, give me one authority. You guys decide who that authority is going to be.
Indeed, the industry wants one authority. They do not want multiplicity of authorities to be assessing them. In fact, I think the finance minister did say that can't have two assessing authorities competing for the same assessee, and that is going to make life nightmarish for all of them. But Bhavna Doshi, you're here with us as well. The finance minister spoke about two possible solutions that are being worked upon and being deliberated upon. One, of course, is the horizontal division that he alluded to, which is out there in the public domain. The other is vertical division. Given the fact that the states are refusing to budge on this one, how do you see, what sort of a solution are you expecting at this stage?
I think something else will have to be thought about, because one of the aspects which we have still not discussed is that an assessee may have operations in more than one state. So the question will also arise between which state will assess him, whether it will be each of the states where he has operations, or can there be one central assessment, because the accounts may be common, some data may be common. So perhaps one of the aspects which they will have to consider is whether there is some way in which they can work out through the GST network a certain threshold, and above that or below that they can work out based on turnover. And if, say, a turnover in a state is more than 50% of the total turnover of that taxpayer, then that state could look at it, and then in that state it could be jointly between the officer from the central government and the state government, who can sit together jointly, so that so far as the taxpayer is concerned, he does not have to, in a sense, be faced by demands from two different authorities. It's common single information that he submits, and the view that is taken is also a common view.
Ms. Bhavna Doshi has raised an important point about this, but Anita Rastogi, you want to come in on this, the point that is being raised, that how do you make sure that every state doesn't start assessing it? They should not be competing authorities assessing, assessing an assessee. The solution is a horizontal and a vertical division, and that is where the bone of contention is. You have some optimistic voices like Haseeb Drabu say that this isn't a deal breaker. But you have others like Thomas Isaac is actually putting on record that this was the toughest day in the GST negotiations. What could be the possible middle path? What will bring some meeting of mind on this matter?
So I would just like to say that, yes, the aspect as to who is going to actually have the control on the assessees, whether it's going to be one or dual, is one of the major, major steps which has to be clarified, and a consensus has to be obtained by the government, because it's a clear ask of the entire industry that we do not want dual control. That's first aspect. The second is, I was a little surprised when I heard Mr. Jaitley saying that any tax evasion which is to be detected based upon intelligence and information will definitely have concurrent jurisdictions. So if we are talking about a single jurisdiction for tax administration for a particular assessee, I would imagine that any tax evasion aspect from an intelligence and information should also be only from a single administration and not concurrent jurisdiction, because that's also going to create a chaos. Now, I don't think that today's decision, which has not yet been taken on this particular control aspect, is anyway going to harm our movement towards GST on 1st of April, because this is one of the very difficult aspect which the government has to sit through, do a brainstorming and come to a proper resolution, where actually it's a win-win both for the center state along with the industries. So the objective has to be that it should be a good administration, ease of doing business, and if it takes a couple of more days or even a week, I don't think it really matters. But what really I didn't like hearing was a concurrent jurisdiction in case of intelligence and information. If that can also be sorted out by a single jurisdiction, it'll be very good.
All right, not impressed with the concurrent jurisdiction in case of intelligence and information. There has to be only one, but let's get in the new guests who have joined us on this leg of the special show, Mr. V.S. Krishna and, of course, Mr. S. Madhavan. Mr. S. Madhavan, let's begin by talking to you. The point that Anita did make, and I think it's an important point about if the consensus does not emerge on this one, I mean, there's an entire timetable that the finance minister gave, which is an informal meeting of the ministers on the 20th, the council then meeting on the 24th and the 25th, the drafts being finalized by the 15th of November, states vetting it, the council approving these drafts in its meeting on the 24th and the 25th. Are these utopian timetable that the government of India is working with? Do you believe it's achievable? And more importantly, if the consensus does not emerge on the dual control deadlock, is April 1, 2017 now looking increasingly difficult?
No, I think my own conviction is that today's inconclusive meeting is not a deal breaker. I believe that the 20th November meeting, which I believe is specifically called for to address this particular issue of controls, should be able to resolve it. I think there is meeting ground between the two administrations. My sense is that it's largely in terms of, you know, the base of the administration, the number of taxpayers, particular to the service tax vis-a-vis the goods taxation, which I think is one of the issues that they have yet to resolve. Witness the public comment by the finance minister of West Bengal to that effect. So I think there are some issues around those kind of procedural and largely contextual matters. But I think in principle, I think I would think that the government of India will adopt a give and take approach. After all, let's bear in mind that this new tax, the dual GST, it has for the first time extended the excise tax, which is the manufacturing tax, beyond the manufacturing stage, right till the retail stage as far as the center is concerned. And we, as regards the state, it is for the first time they are assuming taxation powers over services. So very clearly, very path-breaking kind of reform in the nature of the tax changes very fundamentally. Given that, I am not surprised that this is taking so much time for the states and the center to resolve this issue of how might the administration be implemented. And bearing in mind that, you know, there is that initial level of single control, which is that 1.5 crore limit, which is historical again. I mean, there is no basis to that except the fact that the excise exemption was to that effect, whereas the VAT exemptions were significantly lower, and indeed the exemptions from the GST will also be predicated on the existing VAT levels, more or less. So I think the 20th meeting would achieve a resolution of this particular issue. Insofar as your larger question is concerned as to the 1st of April timeline, is that achievable or not? I in fact mentioned this in your channel yesterday as well, that, and I think the FMS laid out a clear path as to the other elements of the GST puzzle which were to fall in place. Most importantly, the legislation on the central and the state GST laws. And if that be done by December, I can't see why, as far as the government of India and the state governments are concerned, they will not be ready to implement the GST by the 1st of April. As I said yesterday as well, it is the industry which is now struggling to catch up simply because it doesn't have enough time. And in FICCI, we have actually requested that from the time that the central and the state GST laws are ready and put out in the public domain, industry would ideally would want 6 months' time to be prepared and ready for the GST.
Right.
That will not apparently happen, because if the timeline is what you believe, then the industry will not have 6 months. But insofar as the government of India and the state governments are concerned, they are ready and able and I believe willing to start the ball rolling from 1st of April.
Fair point indeed. But let's take this across to Mr. V.S. Krishnan, who's also with us right here on this very special edition. It's important to remember here that the finance minister was optimistic of finding a resolution to this one. And without a resolution to this one, of course, things can't move, even though he rattled a long list of things that need to be done by the 24th or the 25th of November when the council does meet next. Do you expect a resolution, at least at the political level, to emerge in the meantime, Mr. Krishnan?
I think, first of all, one clarification. Just one clarification. First of all, the department doesn't do assessment today. Both in VAT, central excise and service tax, the assessment is done by the SSE. There is a self-assessment situation. So what the departments are now talking about is scrutiny of the assessments done by them. I was fortunate to be on the committee on dual control, threshold and exemptions when we were negotiating with the states. The word control actually is a wrong word. What it really means is who will do the compliance verification of the assessments which the assessees themselves have made. And this compliance verification has three dimensions. One is return scrutiny, the second is audit, and third is intelligence-based scrutiny. As far as audit is concerned, very few small units are generally not audited. So below 1.5 crores, very few units are in any case audited. So what we are really talking about is scrutiny, and the solution is suggested by the FM himself, the contours of the settlement, which is that we are going to rely on online scrutiny. So that's going to take place, and if the GSTN can help, we are slowly moving towards online scrutiny of the smaller units, which is administratively less intrusive. So that's the way forward. So I don't see a problem at all. I think there has been a broad agreement that we must have online scrutiny, and he said that it's very difficult to distinguish between goods and services. Haircuts and hair clips value addition will be treated on par.
Right, right. Just hold your thoughts there, because I want to take this back to Mr. Dimri, who we started this discussion with. And you know, it seemingly appears that if you actually just look at what the finance minister said, he's just talking about the verification of those assessments. And is the situation as simple as perhaps some finance ministers and also Mr. Krishnan is alluding to?
Could you repeat the question? I couldn't hear it.
I'm saying, is the solution as simple as is being alluded to, that this is just a verification administrative issue and it should be resolved? You've had some optimistic finance ministers also say that as well.
Well, I agree with Mr. Krishnan that, you know, the assessment is to be done by the taxpayer and the verification has to be done. But that's not a new concept under GST. We have that self-assessment under all laws now, whether we look at income tax, whether we look at customs, whether we look at service tax. But still, the process of verification in many instances does get to be pretty extensive. You know, the authorities do come to our premises. They have a huge requirement of information and data and document. Sometimes it goes over weeks and weeks and weeks, and sometimes over months. So let us not undermine the importance of this issue, that when there is an authority that's going to exercise control over me, or control or right of re-verification, that re-verification, and if one were to look at least on the model GST law, that power to request information is immense. It's almost endless. So I would not undermine the importance of this issue. And to compound the fact that do I answer to two different agencies who can often reach differing conclusions, that is what the disaster scenario is, that I as a taxpayer at a single location on a single transaction have two competing claims. We have to avoid that at all cost. And that's where the importance of this dual control is, that we have to have one authority, and that one authority will have a right to exercise whatever verification or whatever control is. So I would not undermine it. I think it is an extremely important issue. You know, this is the point at which, as they say, rubber hits the road. So the entire law and the simplification of the law and the business friendliness of the law will get determined as to the point of interaction between the administration and the taxpayer. I think it is an extremely important issue. And dual control, I don't think, is acceptable to the industry. The two governments will have to find a way to create an environment where there is a unified control and unified jurisdiction over a taxpayer.
Bhavna Doshi, come in on that, because it looks like when the meeting essentially started and when discussions started on dual control, even initially, things were weighing in favor of horizontal division. And now some finance ministers in some states are talking about a vertical division as far as, you know, how to divide the SSE base is concerned. For tax experts like yourselves, is a vertical assessment doable? Is that a pragmatic solution at all?
Whichever way we do it, whether horizontal or vertical, so long as one is one has only one authority to deal with. And the point that I made earlier also, across the country, because in one state, if I'm faced with a central authority and in another state by a state authority, again, the same issues could come up. And if different authorities, so when we are talking of single authority, what we need to also bear in mind is that the single authority is across the country. So if I'm being or my returns are being scrutinized, or whatever self-assessment I have done is being verified by a central authority, it should be across the country. And I believe that's what they are looking at. So that should really help. But also one more point which I would like to make is that now what we heard is that the council is going to meet now only on 24th formally and 20th informally. In the meantime, there are a lot of apprehensions on several other issues. So if the government has taken, or the council has taken, any view on that, or if there is some consensus emerging, I would think that that would really help assess its taxpayers, because there is so much of concern as to what's happening on several other areas as well. Dual control, of course, is one of the major issues, but there are several other areas. There are so many areas where drafting needs to be improved, and unintended issues are coming up, I mean, which is what was not expected. So perhaps in the meantime, if they start at least indicating that these are the areas we have relooked at, or this is where we are going to redraft the law, that would help.
Anita Rastogi, you want to come in on that? We're setting very long timelines. 20th is when the informal meeting happens. 15th is when the four laws will be finalized. They'll be then sent to states. They'll come up for the consideration and perhaps pass by the 25th of November. Are we working at too long a timeline? And like Ms. Doshi was pointing out there, in the meantime, we perhaps need to look at things more. I think we have a conversation going with Santosh Gangwar, the Minister of State for Finance, also somebody who sits on the GST meetings, with my colleague Ruchi Bhatia. Let's go across to that. All right, Mr. Gangwar, Santosh Gangwar is the Minister of State for Finance. He's in conversation with Rajeev Bhatia.
Please come.
Mr. Gangwar there in conversation.
Inclusive raha hai. Kafi states ne kafi issues pe bola hai. फाइनेंस मिनिस्टर ने भी बोला एक हॉरिजॉन्टल और एक वर्टिकल तरीके से हम क्रॉस एम्पावरमेंट का इशू देखेंगे. आपको क्या लगता है कि आने वाले टाइम में कितनी जल्दी ये इशू सॉल्व हो सकता है?
मुझे लगता है कि आज की जो बातचीत हुई है अधिकांश राज्यों की सहमति नजर आ रही है. उसको हम जल्दी में ये काम नहीं करना चाहते हैं, तो हम लोगों ने तय करा कि पहले खाली मंत्री लोग बैठकर इसको अंतिम रूप दे दें और 20 तारीख को इसके लिए बैठेंगे. मुझे लगता है कि एक 20 तारीख को एक सही सोल्यूशन निकल जाए।
सर, एक सर्विसेज का जो इशू है वो बहुत इम्पोर्टेंट है कि क्या सर्विसेज और गुड्स उनको कैसे डिवाइड किया जाएगा इस क्रॉस एम्पावरमेंट के इशू में। अभी तक क्या यू नो व्हाट काइंड ऑफ सोल्यूशन हैज बीन रीच्ड ऑन दिस मैटर?
ना, अब इसके बारे में बातचीत हो चल रही है, 24-25 को मुझे लगता है ये अंतिम रूप
से। जिन्होंने इशू
सारे ही राज्य अपना पक्ष रखते हैं, खासतौर से चाहे तमिलनाडु रहा हो, जो भी रहा हो, चाहे कर्नाटक रहा हो, पंजाब रहा हो, सबने पक्ष रखा और सबके पक्ष उपयुक्त थे।
आईजीएसटी और जो सीजीएसटी ने क्या बोला? जो आईजीएसटी और जो सीजीएसटी
केरला ने क्या बोला? केरला क्योंकि काफी वोकल है इन सब चीजों को लेकर।
सब के मुझे लगता है कि सब सही ढंग से बात कर रहे हैं और सबकी राय एक सी नजर।
जो आईजीएसटी और सीजीएसटी के जो ड्राफ्ट लेजिस्लेशन है उसमें कहाँ तक चीजें आगे बढ़ी हैं और क्या हम आने वाले
आज के बाद ये शुरू हो जाएगा और इसीलिए समय आगे बढ़ाया गया है कि अब हम लोग तय करके फिर राज्यों को भेजेंगे। इसमें 4-5 दिन लगेंगे, उसके बाद राज्यों से जाने के बाद में मुझे लगता है कि इस सत्र में पारित हो जाएगा।
ठीक है सर, थैंक यू सो मच।
इंपॉर्टेंट कॉन्वर्सेशन देयर विद रिपोर्टर्स एंड एज ऑलवेज ईटी नाउ गेट्स इट्स फर्स्ट एंड एक्सक्लूसिव। बट अनीत, आई एम गोइंग टू रैप दिस डिस्कशन एंड सो विल अर्ज ईच वन ऑफ यू टू बी ब्रीफ। अनीता, यू वांट टू कम इन ऑन द फैक्ट दैट वी आर वर्किंग एट टाइमलाइंस that seem to be a little too long drawn here?
So I think there is just too much, for the government to do on the aspect of the draft GST law, etc. And there are a lot of representations which have already gone. So I really don't think that the fact that they are taking a little more additional time is going to be a problem. Till the time that in the winter session of the parliament, the GST bill is passed, I think that's okay. Whether they are going to formalize the GST, send the final draft on 24th of November or on 20th of November, it doesn't really matter. Till the time the winter session of the parliament actually passes this GST bill, I think that should be okay.
Winter session of parliament actually begins on the 12th of November. I have quick closing comments to take from my three panelists, the men on our panel. And Rajeev Dimri, let's begin with you. Are we looking, yesterday we cheered and we applauded what had happened, which was consensus that had emerged. But it looks like today there is some room for concern, some room for thought. Is April 1, 2017 still doable according to you?
Well, I would not consider today's conversation and this so-called deadlock to be coming in the larger timeline. This is a important issue. It would take time to solve, but the states have to come back and agree that while they may have their own personal preferences as to who has the control, at the end of the day, the administration has to achieve a more simplified tax environment for the taxpayers in the country, and that has to be the primary objective here. I heard the finance minister say that there will be a scrutiny and only 5% of the taxpayers will be selected. I think if that gets baked into the process, in itself would be a huge step forward. So yes, we do need to satisfactorily resolve the dual control, but just because there is no consensus today, I would not treat that as some major roadblock in the overall timeline. So I still welcome the thought that there will be a computer-based, risk-based selection process. Only 5% of the taxpayers will be selected. And I do hope that the respective agencies will agree that there has to be a unified control over taxpayers. Dual control is not an acceptable solution.
Dual control, not an acceptable solution. There has to be a unified control. There can't be competing authorities for an SSE. Quick closing comments from Mr. Madhavan then there.
Yeah, I just want to add on the point, the one element of this discussion on dual control, which is that you essentially, what does the industry want? It wants a single transaction to be assessed in a particular manner, not in two different ways by two different administrations. Similarly, a dispute or a classification or whatever be the matter should be addressed similarly. I just want to highlight the fact that we do have the GST, the overall Constitution Amendment Bill is already there. The GST code is there. They are all there. And if you were to look at them, the provisions that are there across the central and the state GST laws, albeit in draft form, are varying. And this is because historically they've been drafted at different times in periods of time and implemented differently for the purpose of central and state legislations. Therefore, I think it's imperative also to understand in this broader discussion on dual control that we are essentially apprehending a dissimilarity and a differentiated and a variegated treatment of similar provisions by two different taxing authorities. And therein lies the concern. Let's understand, industry has faced the federal administration through the central excise and separately the state administration through the VAT for years. That is not the concern, and that's something that industry is entirely familiar and comfortable doing. The apprehension is with regard to the fact that now the GST changes the rules of the game, and you have very similar kind of provisions which are going to be interpreted differently. That's the challenge, simply because of the fact that historically they've been drafted and treated differently. So that, I believe, is the one concern that I would like to bring out. And if that is addressed in a satisfactory manner,
right,
then the aspect of whether you are horizontally or vertically carrying out administration, to my mind, becomes largely academic.
Mr. Krishnan, since you've been a part of the law that is perhaps going to be passed and debated and deliberated upon, it's important to ask you, is it irrelevant how the assessee base is divided? Because eventually, it's how they're administered that really matters.
Yeah, actually, the point here is, if you take the 1.5 crore issue, up to 20 lakhs threshold, there is an exemption, which means up to 20 lakhs turnover, neither the center nor the states will exercise control. Between 20 and 50 lakhs, there is going to be a compounding system where a flat rate of duty will be paid, and that too is not going to be scrutinized. So within the 1.5 crores up to 50 lakhs, neither states nor center will have control. So that takes care of the small. So now we are talking about the medium small between 50 and 1.5 crores. And there the finance minister has indicated that the GSTN could throw the risk triggers, based on which a small portion would be selected for online scrutiny,
right,
which is administratively non-intrusive. There lies the solution. So the small is in any case out. Up to 50 lakhs, no control either by the center nor by the states.
That's right, indeed. The technology disruption that will come in from the GSTN is perhaps where the solution lies. We do hope and keep our fingers crossed that the GST Council that will formally meet on the 24th and the 25th and the finance ministers of states that will meet informally on the 20th of November will be able to find a solution to this one. It's a crucial one before we head to the destination of the biggest tax reform in India, and that's the Goods and the Services Tax. Thanks each one of you for being with us on this very special edition. We'll keep it with news and views that matter right here on ET Now. We'll be right back.